Yes.
Actually, I'm just curious. Did Bishop de Galarreta and Bishop Tissier de Mauray modify their stance before or after you were expelled?
Did the two bishops modify the position before or after I was expelled? I think Bishop de Galarreta soon after. I think Bishop Tissier before. Bishop Tissier said to me that he listened to Bishop Foley's arguments for my exclusion at the chapter, because the question of my exclusion from the chapter came up. Then it was not my exclusion from the society, it was my exclusion from the chapter. And Bishop Tissier told me that he found Bishop Foley's arguments persuasive. So he's not been fooled by, Bishop Tissier was not fooled by me, you might say. Say it how you like, listen to the other side. You know, listen to both sides of the argument. But I think Bishop Tissier, insofar as Bishop Tissier's doctrinal position has not changed, and it's absolutely against an agreement with Rome. But his practical position shifted after the letter of the three. The letter of the three. When did it shift? I would say before my exclusion. I think Bishop Garrett's soon after. Bishop Garrett's shifted in public soon after, but it may have shifted in private before. Yeah? Any other questions? Yes. That's it. That's it. He lived 1991. He died in April of 91. No, March of 91. March the 25th of 91. But that was his position. At the end, he was very clear. He was clear before, you know, but before it seems less clear because he was still trying to, he was still saying, this is tradition, this is the faith, this is what you've got to stay with. But he was still hoping to be able to get Rome to come along with tradition. He was still hoping to do some good to Rome. But when it, and those are the quotes that are used now by the management of the society. But when it became clear what Rome was up to, then that was it. No more diplomacy, from now on, only doctrine. And he was a diplomat, and he did his best, but he was also doctrinal. And of course, doctrine is fundamental to diplomacy. Diplomacy is to serve doctrine. This is what modern heads don't understand, the importance of doctrine. Many people, you know, doctrine is a dirty word. Indoctrination is a dirty word. Dogma is a dirty word. It shouldn't be for Catholics. It shouldn't be for Catholics. But there it is. Because, you see, the instinct today is that a dogma limits the liberty of my mind. It's a limitation of my liberty. The church is telling me what to think, and I've got to think what the church tells me in order to be a Catholic. I don't like that. I want to be free to think, and at the same time be a Catholic. You can't have it both ways. The same way of looking at doctrine is there was an Englishman in the 19th century, an English Catholic, I think it was a convert, I forget his name, and he said, I would be quite happy if every morning there arrived a new dogma with my copy of the Times. And he was right. What he meant was every dogma that the church defines is another building block for the mind to build a great fortress of truth, one row of blocks on another. So that he wasn't looking for liberty, he was looking for truth. And therefore, he was the way he had a picturesque way of saying, that he would be he was grateful for every solid truth that the church gave him. That's not the attitude today. That's the sound attitude to dogma. That welcomes dogmas. Because these dogmas build my mind, build its certainty, and build its security, its grip on truth. That's the same way of looking at it, and the same way of looking at doctrine. But that's not the modern way, because of liberty and because of liberalism. And people today want to have mush heads. They want to do away with common sense. They want to wash out their common sense. And the common sense is being washed out. How many people still have any common sense? Fewer and fewer. What is common sense? People no longer know. Because now the little boys are being taught to be little girls in the kindergarten, and the little girls are being taught to be little boys, and the difference between a cock and a hen, between a bull and a cow, between a ram and a ewe, between a etc., etc., that's being washed out. It's in all the animals. Every peasant knows the difference between male and female. And it's not difficult to recognize that even the difference between the human male and the human female bears resemblances to the difference between male animals and female animals. And so the boy that's been brought up on a farm has got some good sense about male and female. But in today's suburbs, in today's kindergartens, in today's suburbs, that common sense is being deliberately washed out. Because common sense belongs to nature, nature belongs to God. Modern man is making war on God. Therefore, he's making war on human nature. Lenin said, we communists are going to change human nature. And he's making war on common sense. And therefore, common sense is disappearing. That's how serious the problem is. That's why we've got liberalism. And if you've got a mush head, the idea of a solid doctrine, of a fixed doctrine, just doesn't jibe. I want to be free. I want to leave to non-Catholics the liberty to be non-Catholics. That's Vatican II. That's a no. For Catholics, that's a no-no. A Catholic wants all his fellow men to get to heaven. And they're not going to get to heaven by anything except the true religion, unadulterated and unchanged, of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yes. That's my answer.
It's a very positive question for the whole world. That
sure.
The world has obviously grown with. We have hope in you.
Sure. Don't put too much hope in me, because I can rat just like anybody else can rat. We're only human beings. The thought has obviously occurred to me, and if it didn't occur to me, it would be occurred to me by other people. I personally, right now, don't feel in a... my hunch is that it's not a hurry. Right now, I don't think there's a hurry. I could be wrong. I quote the Archbishop waited to consecrate. To him too, many people were suggesting the idea. People are talking about it to Bishop Tissier as well. That I know. And Bishop Tissier has mentioned it to Bishop Foley. Bishop Tissier has said, is reported to have said to Bishop Foley something like, if you go on with this policy, I'm going to consecrate some bishops. He's reported as saying that. I've not got proof that he said it. Okay, so I don't know. But I think of it, yes. I don't think there's a hurry. I may be wrong. If I am wrong, and if I disappear before I do anything, before I consecrate a bishop, have confidence in God. God is not going to abandon his church. So I don't think everything depends upon me. I really don't. I have a responsibility, yes. Total dependence, no. God is God, way above me. Way, way, way above me. So trust in God. Trust in God much more than you trust in me. Infinitely more than you trust in me. I don't know if that answer satisfies you. I am thinking about it. I do think about it. I think about candidates. At this point in time, I'm not in a hurry. It's a big decision, and it needs time. Okay? Maybe you're not satisfied with that answer, in which case I'm sorry, but yes. Well, who is in line with the Archbishop? The resistance, such as it is, and it's not yet taken any much concrete form, is the resistance, such as it is, in line with the Archbishop, or is society headquarters in line with the Archbishop? Which of them is more in line with the Archbishop? And I would say, even though the resistance so far has not taken much consistency or much form, such as it is, it's more in line with the Archbishop's thinking than society headquarters on their present course. So the grace of the Archbishop may be more with the resistance than with the society headquarters. Also, remember, Scripture says, God resists the proud, he gives his grace to the humble. Have society priests been proud? Have they behaved as though they are the bee's knees and the cat's whiskers, and anybody outside the society, any priest outside the society who's not a society priest, is an inferior species? If that has been the thinking, it's a pride which God will have punished, or will punish. That's where I think grace may be lost, by pride. Certainly not all society priests have been proud, but I do think some have fallen into the trap of thinking outside the society, no salvation, and that's a great mistake. Towards the back, yes. Well, let's say that true tradition, is between liberalism on one side and sedevacantism on the other. Okay? And that actually sedevacantism is the flip side of liberalism. Sedevacantism and liberalism are like heads and tails of the same coin. That sounds strange, but the two are maybe closer to one another than either of them is close to tradition. How can that be? Because sedevacantists and liberals both make the same mistake of exaggerating papal infallibility. The liberals say, the popes are infallible, the popes are liberal, therefore liberalism is the truth. And that's what a lot of Catholics have been thinking. The sedevacantists say, the popes are infallible, these popes are liberal, therefore they're not popes. Two very different conclusions from the same premises. Where's the error? The logic is logical. The popes are liberal, the popes are infallible, therefore the liberalism is the truth. The popes are liberal, liberalism is a miserable error, therefore they're not popes. Or the popes are infallible, liberalism is not infallible, therefore these liberal popes are not popes. The error is in the exaggeration of papal infallibility. And tradition does not exaggerate papal infallibility. Tradition understands papal infallibility not in a lazy way, but in a thinking way. The Pope must be talking as Pope, as head of the Universal Church, on a question of faith and morals, in a definitive manner. This is it, boys, and with the purpose of binding the whole church. Those are the four conditions on which he's infallible. If any of those four conditions are absent, he's not infallible. He can make mistakes. But what both liberals and sedevacantists do is take things that he says when he's certainly not trying to bind the whole church as though it's absolutely true simply because it's the Pope saying them. Papal infallibility needs some careful understanding. And so tradition makes God infallible, but not any human being. The Pope is only under certain strict conditions infallible. And that stops a traditionalist from being either a sedevacantist or a liberal. That's my view. I think that's what the Archbishop's view. I think it would be Bishop Foley's view. Yes. Does that answer your question?
Well, where does the obligation of obedience to the Pope come into play? The balance between if the Pope wants to talk to you, are you obligated to open a dialogue with them versus...
That's a good question. If the Pope wants to talk to you, are you obligated to open a dialogue with him? I would say... you're certainly obligated to listen to what he's saying, to take seriously what he says. But if he is wrong, if he is a conciliarist, you could say, Holy Father, when you come back to the doctrine of your predecessors, of your 260 predecessors before John the 23rd, when you come back to that doctrine, very gladly I will listen to you, talk to you, and submit to you. But until you come back to that doctrine, which is the doctrine of the church, I'm sorry, I won't dare to talk to you because you might pull me into error, even though you are the Holy Father. I would speak respectfully, with charity, with courtesy, but if he was holding to conciliar doctrine, I would say, Holy Father, thank you, but no thank you. That doesn't answer your question?
Yeah. I don't say that you cannot say that's
it.
Not the Pope.
That's it.
So obviously that means if you have the idea that sedevacantism is not per se forbidden or not even a Catholic teaching, because there are times when it's possible, just like the public character can't hold office.
Yep. The question is sedevacantism. And the quotation, there's a quotation of the Archbishop who I do believe said something like this at least once. I don't say that the Pope is not Pope, but I don't say either that you cannot say that the Pope is not Pope. In other words, the Archbishop recognized that the see might be vacant. It's not impossible that the see should be vacant. It's not impossible to, I think that was the Archbishop's position. He often said that he believed that the Pope was Pope. Only twice publicly raised a real question mark. But he also, in August of 1976, and I think around Pentecost of 1985. Otherwise, he often said that he really believed that the Pope was Pope. So he did not share. He did not finish on the sedevacantist position, but he did not completely exclude it either. I think that's a fair statement of the Archbishop's position. Yes.
I think there are too many definitions of it. Now, to me, a strict state of Vacantis says that we have not had a pope since Pius XII.
Yes.
All right. Now, whatever reasons, I'm not going to go into that because there are too many ways to argue about it. However, to me, to say such a thing calls into question both the indefectibility of the church and its visibility. Okay?
There are.
Now, on the other hand, looking at it from their viewpoint, I can see why they would believe such a thing. But as a Catholic, I cannot agree with that.
Okay, fine. That's fair enough. What the great principle of St. Augustine is, in certis unitas, in dubiis libitas, in omnibus caritas. That's about 9 words, and like many of Augustine's sayings, it's a wealth of wisdom in a handful of words. In things certain, unity. In things doubtful, liberty. In all things, charity. And I think that's what applies in this case. It seems to be not certain. There are strong arguments why the see has not been vacant, it is not vacant, but it seems to be not, given the drama of these conciliar popes and how much destruction has been done to the church underneath them, it's understandable that some Catholics, good Catholics, simply cannot accept that these popes are popes. I don't agree with them. Myself, I've never been a Sede Vacantis, but I can understand Sede Vacantis, and I don't think that generally speaking they're as bad as liberals. That's just an opinion. But the Sede Vacantis is dangerous, can be dangerous, because it becomes the most important truth of the Catholic faith that the see is vacant. And that's a grave exaggeration. It's not the most important truth that a Catholic needs to know. It's an exaggeration, and it's an exaggeration which can make a Catholic very sterile. It's called bitter zeal. And then, you know, the point comes where they won't even attend Mass on Sunday, even a decent Mass, because the church is over, the church is finished, there's no pope, etc., etc., etc. One has to be careful. I've never been a Sede Vacantis, and I wouldn't encourage people to be Sede Vacantis. I understand it if they are, I don't encourage them to be. But it's, yes. Yeah.
And then how this split relates with that, and you know, are they relieved of those vows? And I don't quite understand how.
There's no vow by which a priest belongs to the society. It's rather a promise, as you say. And that promise has not got the weight of a vow. And therefore there is not a formal release from that promise, as there needs to be some kind of release from a vow. Okay? So the promise is a comparatively lightweight affair. I personally think that it was wise of the Archbishop to have rather promises than vows. I think myself that a lightweight structure was indicated in the 1970s and 1980s. When life was stable and the world was much more stable, vows were practical and useful. But from the 19th century onwards, you know, the great heavyweight congregations like the Franciscans, the Dominicans, the Jesuits, the Benedictines, the 19th century congregations were comparatively lightweight compared with those earlier orders. They're called congregations rather than orders. And in the 20th century, maybe even lighter. And you know, you may know my opinion up till now, that the resistance maybe does not need this resistance, however doctrinally true and however wise it may be, I'm not sure that it needs to be structured or overstructured. You may have heard me say that up till now, I think it may be better if it remains a lightweight network of pockets of resistance without a formal structure. I can be wrong. Father Pfeiffer would prefer a stronger structure, and he has his reasons. In dubiis libertas, I'm not going to lay down the law that he's wrong. I'm not going to lay down the law that I'm right. But I think that the lightweight involvement is not unwise. Yes.
The ones that also, there's a commitment for, I guess, for life, is that correct?
It begins with several commitments of 1 year, then one or two or three commitments of 3 years, and after that is allowed a commitment for life, yes.
And those are still just like quotable promises, is that correct?
That's all promises. It's not heavier than a promise. That's how it works. It's not something to be taken lightly, but it's not as heavy as a vow. Right?
Because obviously, you know, you're concerned for these priests in these difficult times.
Yes.
And the promises they made for the open tabernacle as far as...
Yes, but you know...
Society, you can understand the concern.
Of course. But the faith comes first. I mean, at the time of Vatican II, there were Dominicans and Benedictines and Jesuits who had taken heavy vows. Heavy vows. But what they could say then was that they weren't abandoning their congregation or their order. It was their order that had abandoned them by abandoning the true doctrine. And I made a promise to the Archbishop Lefebvre Society. I may argue that Bishop Furley's society is no longer Archbishop Lefebvre's society, that Bishop Furley has changed the purpose and the doctrine of the Archbishop's society, and the promise that I made to the Archbishop's society no longer binds me to Bishop Furley's society. That's an argument that can be made. Okay. Yes. I'm sorry, the conditions?
Your views on the society's conditions for
you? As the six conditions.
Yes.
Well, I'm not sure I've got them all in my head. But overall, they're pretty weak. I'm sorry, I would need the text in front of me in order not to talk up in the air. I remember the first three are absolute conditions, and the last three are like optional. Now, for starters, who goes into a negotiation saying that I'll give away this, but I'll hold on to this, but I'll give away it? What's the purpose of saying what you'll give away? And Bishop Furley has recognized in public that it was a mistake to say that the three last conditions should be optional. He's admitted that. That's one point about those six conditions. I'm sorry, I can't talk about them without having the text in front of me. But they, overall, they're weak. They are weak tea. The society makes a great mistake when it does not insist absolutely on doctrine in the face of these Romans. If you have the true doctrine, then from the Catholic point of view, you are in the driving seat. With the true doctrine, you are in the driving seat. And you owe nothing to people who've dropped the true doctrine. Because Catholicism is firstly doctrinal. Going, teach all nations. That's in Latin, docete. That's the last instructions of our Lord to his apostles. Going, teach all nations. And they must observe all things that I have taught you. The word teaching comes twice. Because if I didn't teach the existence of heaven, the immortality of the soul, and the necessity of Jesus Christ in order to save one's soul, if I don't teach these great truths, who's going to bother to become a Catholic? The reason to become a Catholic is to save my soul. To save my soul, I need to know that I need absolutely our Lord Jesus Christ and his sacraments. That's doctrine. And that our Lord Jesus Christ is God, true God and true man, doctrine. If I don't teach, if I abandon these doctrines or put skids under them, like the Second Vatican Council, I'm putting skids under the whole church. So he who's got the doctrine for Catholics is in the driving seat. Now there's a quotation of our Lord again in the Gospel of St. John where he says to the Pharisees something like this: if I said that I did not have the truth, I would be a liar like you are. Like you all are. I'm sorry, I don't have the exact words. I think it's chapter 8 again, the famous chapter 8 of St. John. Find those words. If I backed down on my claims, if I said you don't have to believe that I am God or the Son of God, if I said that you don't need me to get to heaven, I would be a liar just like you are. If therefore the society says, you can adopt Catholic doctrine or conciliar doctrine, it doesn't matter, the society would be a liar. If the society cannot, no Catholic can back down from the absolute necessity of complete Catholic truth. And if it does, any Catholic who backs down from the absolute doctrinal claims of the Church, any Catholic who backs down from the doctrine is a liar. He may be trying to be nice. He may mean well. He may be sincere. He may have good intentions, but objectively, he's a liar. And that's the position, that's the strength of the position which the society should be taking opposite Rome. The society should be saying, you Romans, you're very sweet. You're very nice. I love you dearly. I love your purple buttons. I love your purple halls. I have the utmost respect for intelligence. But if you're abandoning this doctrine and that doctrine, you are a bunch of Pharisees and liars. What? I said you're a bunch of Pharisees and liars. That's it. That's what the little martyred virgin said to the emperor. The emperor said, my child, if you sacrifice two grains of incense, or if you cannot say that I worship devils. Your Majesty, the child is very respectful to the great Roman Emperor. Your Majesty, I worship Jesus Christ. He is the one true God. You are worshiping devils. If you want to save your soul, you must stop doing that. What? If you don't say that, I will give you the most handsome young man, a limousine, 5 autobuses, 3 country houses, anything you like. If you keep on saying it, I will torture you with rack and rope and everything. The little girl goes on saying it, which is why she became a virgin martyr. You can't back down from the claims, the absolute claims of Catholic truth. The little girl stood up to the great emperors. And the little society should be standing up to rotten Rome. Doctrinally rotten Rome. I'm sorry, the doctrinally rotten Romans. The society should be standing up. And if the society backs down and says, on these conditions we might, the society is coming close to lying. If it's not actually lying, it's coming close. It's backing down from the absolute position which it should be holding. And it's not a question of pride to be taking this position. It's a question of humility. I submit to this same doctrine to which all of us should submit. It's not my doctrine. I can't be proud of it. Our Lord himself says to the Pharisees, my doctrine is not my doctrine. The doctrine I'm giving you doesn't come from me. It comes from my Father. My doctrine is not my doctrine. Our Lord says that his doctrine is not his doctrine. How much more should every Catholic say, the doctrine that we Catholics pronounce doesn't belong to us, it wasn't invented by us, and it cannot be changed by us. It belongs to God, it came from God, I submit, I must submit, you must submit if you wish to save your soul. You Romans are rotten in doctrine. Get clear. And that's the greatest favor that the society could be rendering to the Romans, not pretending that there's some way that there can be some kind of agreement. Because a practical agreement without doctrine suggests that doctrine is not all that important. A practical agreement without doctrine is a mushifier. It produces mush. It encourages mush. It helps to make mush minds. It's not a good thing. Doctrine is what must govern practice, and not practice govern doctrine. Modern people can't grasp the importance of doctrine because they can't grasp truth. They've lost grip on truth. Truth is objective, it's absolute, it's non-contradictory, it's coherent. It cannot contradict. No one truth can contradict any other truth. If two propositions contradict one another, either one of them is false and the other is true, or they're both false. But they cannot both be true. For the modern mind, it doesn't matter what you think. All contradictions are possible. Contradiction doesn't matter. Ideas don't matter. That's the modern way of thinking. It's, as the Archbishop said, a profound philosophical perversity. Many people today have perverse minds. Minds which are not working. Which cannot work properly. Because they want minds that can't work properly, because they don't want to be told by the curtain that it's only a curtain. They don't want to have to submit to reality. They want their fantasy in place of reality. There's nothing to be done. You can't be Catholic on that basis. And that's the real problem. It's very deep and very broad. Yes. I'm sorry, would it be wrong to? Absolutely. It's absolutely wrong to ask anybody's permission to profess the doctrine which is of God. Every man has an absolute right to profess the truth that comes from God. Not only a right, even a duty. And so to ask permission to proclaim the truth of God is definitely, it's exactly what I said. It's backing down on the claims. It's being a liar. Yes. Right.
We are kind of a microcosm of resistance here.
Okay.
The problem is, I think, in talking to several who are of a mind to resist what is going on.
Yes.
We're not all on the same page about how to resist.
Sure.
Could I ask you on behalf of these people, myself included, to in the future help us out in manners or in ways that we could constantly resist together and remain together in our resistance, either at the Liaison Commons in the future conferences. We know you're flying out here tomorrow sometime, so
right.
We can't go into this at any length. But this is a problem, I think, that we face here, about how to resist. What form should our resistance take?
Yeah, there's a practical question, yes. That's a very good question. Myself, at this point in time, I don't yet see clearly what form it should take. I might wish that many more priests would come out in public. Because if the priests would lead, the laity would find it much more easy to follow. For the moment, not many priests are coming out, either here or in Europe. But I know that in France, there are a lot of priests that are not happy with this tendency, with this drift. Are they going to take action? It may well come to the danger is that if some action is not taken, one drifts. That is a real danger. One gets used to the drift today, then one it goes a little further tomorrow, one gets used to it tomorrow. And I've said, I think a few moments ago, I know of a number of good priests who are not as good as they were because of the strong wind blowing from the top of the society. Can I push them? Can I push them to come out into the open more? Well, in a recent Eleison comments, I said to priests that the letter of Archbishop de Noia may be a trial balloon to find out how much reaction there is from priests, because his letter is addressed to all the priests of the society. And I think that SSPX headquarters sent his letter to all priests of the society, as only SSPX headquarters could do, because only SSPX headquarters had all the addresses. So I think Archbishop de Noia invited the headquarters to send this nicey-nicey letter to all the priests, and it was sent. I said in public, dear priests, you had better, if you don't want to be swallowed alive by Rome, you had better react. You had better make it clear to your district superiors. I said, make clear to your district superiors, however, as discreetly as you wish, that you want nothing but nothing to do with Concilia Rome until it comes back to the true doctrine. I think that's about what I said. So, the first, here and now, the first practical action that I might myself wish for is that priests would at least react in private to their district superiors and make clear that if this drift continues, if the society continues to drift into liberalism, then they're not going to go with it. That's maybe not enough, but that is what I've said so far. I've said that I can understand priests that don't act. I do approve, in principle, of the priests that are acting and that are, for instance, providing yourselves, if you wish, with the sacraments every 2 weeks. I personally approve of that. There may be problems involved, there may be things I would disagree with, but I think it's a practical action for souls in distress, in a real distress. As such, I absolutely don't argue with it. I approve. I'm not doing it, but I am coming. One or two or three of you invited me to Post Falls, and that's why I'm here. So I am myself traveling according to invitation at the moment, like I think the Archbishop did at the beginning of the society. He sent priests where they were invited. He was getting calls from all over the world, and he either himself visited or sent a priest to visit according to the demand. Because where there's no demand, there's going to be no response. So I would think the laity should, if you ask me what action now, let the laity read. Let the laity pray, of course. Let them read. Let them read, especially the Archbishop, if they're capable of reading that. Let them study the case. Let them listen to the officials of the SSPX, let them listen to the resistance, let them make up their own minds, but let them study. Let them love their religion and take it seriously enough, and take seriously enough the need to get to heaven, that they take some pains to find out what they should be thinking and doing right now. The priests, let them at least put their district, let them also study, if they haven't studied, let them read the Archbishop, who is the great guide that God gave us. Let them read the Archbishop, let them at the least, in private, put their district superiors under pressure to do their duty by our Lord's doctrine. And if necessary, write also to headquarters in Switzerland and put headquarters under pressure. Because headquarters, if headquarters realizes this, then I think Rome turned down Bishop Foley's offer of mid-April. Rome turned it down because the letter of the three bishops made it clear to Rome that that Bishop Foley would not carry enough of the society with him to make it worthwhile for Rome. I think. Other people think that. Whether or not that is the case, it's certain that the more pressure of the right kind, respectful of course, from below, comes to bear on the higher authorities, the more hope there is that those higher authorities will not be foolish. But, as the Archbishop said, superiors mold subjects and not subjects mold superiors. And that's a real risk for today's situation, because if the superiors continue on their present course, they're going to continue blowing this wind, which is making, I say, a number of good priests bend, sway with the wind in not a good way. It's understandable, but so there's some practical action for laity and priests for the moment. That may change tomorrow, the day after. That tomorrow the situation may become more clear and more urgent. That's what it's liable to do. But we'll have to wait until that happens. I think Father Pfeiffer would like me to take a stronger position, a more definite position. In doubtful things, liberty is all I can say. It's not yet clear to me that more action should yet be taken. I'm sorry if that's not clear enough. Yes. Father Chazal is presently out in Asia. There is, I think, he has faithful, he has followers or people attached to tradition and who've understood the problem in all of those Asian countries. They're surely not numerous, there's not many of them. But there is a small number, like everywhere. It's the remnant. It's a remnant of a remnant. So you're not going to expect it to be a large number. Here in the United States, here in France, it's a remnant of a remnant. The ISSBX was already a remnant, and now the resistance, such as it is for the moment only the remnant of a remnant. And I'm not sure that tomorrow it's going to be that much more numerous. I don't know. It's one thing that remains to be seen. The time will tell. We're dealing with a whole lot of human beings, each of whom has free will. So I don't know. That's one thing that one's got to watch for. You can't deal in wishes. You've got to deal in realities. People might wish that I would take a stronger stand. Well, okay. Okay, I think some of the things I've said today are quite strong. Patience. I say patience. I've been saying that to a number of people for a little while. Paciencia todo lo alcanza, says St. Teresa of Avila. Patience obtains everything. So I think, I think the situation is evolving all the time, and I think things will become clearer. At the moment, there is, of course, a great deal of confusion. I think things will become clearer. They were becoming clearer before the general chapter of July, but then the general chapter produced confusion again, pretending that something could be reconciled which basically can't be reconciled, I think. Maybe one more question. Yes, time is passing. We're nearly half past nine.
There seems to be a crisis in leadership in the family and in the church.
Yes.
In the secular world and all over within the society.
Yes.
Can that be tied into Fatima with the diabolical disorientation?
Oh, yes. This solution, it should be said and said. The real solution to this whole crisis was given to us by the Mother of God nearly 100 years ago. There's no way in which heaven is going to allow humanity in getting to such a mess without offering it the means of getting out of the mess. That was the consecration of Russia by the Pope in union with the bishops of the church to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. I always compare it, you may remember, to General Naaman. I love that story in the Old Testament. General Naaman was a five-star general with scrambled egg all over his shoulders and all over his hat. And he was a big shot in the Syrian army. But he was a leper. He had leprosy. And then he had this little Israeli serving girl. And the Israeli serving girl said, General, if I know back home in Israel, there's a prophet who could cure your leprosy. What? Yes, inquire about it and see. He really could. So he inquires, and sure enough, he informs himself. He gets the military intelligence agency on the job, and he finds, yes, Elijah's living in a cave somewhere lost in Israel, or Elisha, I forget which. Elijah, I think. And so he gets permission from his king to go and visit Israel, and he visits Israel, and he asks the king of Israel for permission to go and see the prophet. The king of Israel is very suspicious. He thinks the general is coming as a spy, but anyway, he's allowed to go. So he goes to visit the prophet in his cave, and he arrives in his limousine with five-star flags on all four corners of his limousine, and he drives up to the cave of Elijah. And he sends his aide-de-camp in to see the Elijah. I hear you're a prophet and you could cure me of leprosy. Please, kindly come out and cure me of leprosy. And the prophet doesn't move. The prophet sends the servant back and says, tell the general, all he need do is bathe seven times in the River Jordan. What? Won't he even come out to see me? I am a five-star general. This is ridiculous. The aide says to him, General, if the prophet had asked you to do something big, wouldn't you have done it? Of course I'm a general, five-star general. Of course I'd do something big. Well, look, he's only asking you to do something quite little. Won't you do it? Buff. Buff. Meet me at midnight, when nobody's around. Show me the way down to the river. Midnight comes, when nobody's around, there are no tourists and nobody. So the aide takes the great general down to the river. All right, now leave me. Because he doesn't want to spoil his uniform, so he's going to be in his underwear, so he doesn't want the aide to see he's in his underwear. So the aide moves discreetly away, and then the general, make sure nobody's looking, begins to bathe in the river. He gets into the river once, he's still leprosy. Twice, three, four, five times, still got leprosy. Well, in for a penny, in for a pound, six times, still leprosy. Seven times he bathes in and out, the leprosy's gone. A tiny little thing that he's asked to do, but which is going to require humility. If only the popes were humble enough to do what the Mother of God asks, all of this problem would begin to clear up. And that's the one thing that must be done. We are struggling in our own little way to keep, but mark you, that this is the last comment for tonight. the Mother of God said, not only must the Pope consecrate Russia to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, she also said the Catholics must practice the five first Saturdays. And if Catholics took her seriously and practiced, if Catholics were numerous enough to practice the five first Saturdays, to take her at her word, and to believe that they have got a pretty sure ticket to heaven if they do exactly what she asks. The five first Saturdays, a communion, a confession, communion, a rosary, and a quarter hour of meditation. If they would only do that, five consecutive first Saturdays, that would seriously help the Pope to consecrate Russia. And that's what we can do. So, my dear friends, let's finish on that tonight. Let's say a prayer and we'll be on our way. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy. Hail our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning in this valley of tears. Turn then, most gracious Advocate, thine eyes of mercy towards us, and after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Let me give you a blessing. Benedictio Domino Potentis, Patris, et Filius, Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos, et maniat semper. Amen.